I would like to thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to present today. It's a pity I cannot be in Lund, in the south of Sweden, in the tropical south of Sweden, to be with you. But anyway, we're having a very nice day here in Stockholm as well. So the title of my talk is Hemicelluloses, Molecular Structure Assembly in Plant Cell Walls and Food Applications. And I also wanted to highlight the contribution of Cecil Yilmaz. He's the PhD student who has basically introduced our group into the wonders of X-ray and neutron scattering. So she's a very, very big contributor of this presentation. So the starting point of the research that we do in my group is actually understanding the molecular structure and supramolecular assembly of plant cell walls. And from a biological point of view, plant cell walls is the tissue that is the tissue that surrounds plant cells and provides them with different functions such as structural support and other regulatory functions. And also plant cell walls are the main renewable resource from plant biomass that we can use for bioenergy and also for material applications. But also in this context, in the context of the Nordic life cycle of food, plant cell walls are very important components in many plant-based foods, for example, in cereals, in fruits and vegetables, etc. So basically understanding the structure is very important, not only to utilize the different components that are present in these plant-based foods, but also to understand the viability and all the other properties. So from a molecular perspective, plant cell walls are very complex and hierarchical structures composed mainly by polysaccharides. And here you can see a sketch of the composition and assembly of cereal plant cell walls, where we have cellulose microfibrils embedded in a matrix of different matrix polysaccharides, like, for example, arabinoxylans and beta-glucans. We have also pectins, proteins, phenolics, lignin, etc. So you can see this is a very complex and rich composition of different molecules. All of them have different molecular structure depending on the tissue, depending on the variety, depending on the developmental stage. And also what is important to understand is that what contributes to plant cell wall function and recalcitrance is what are the different interactions between the different components. We have covalent cross-linking, we have hydrogen bonding, nonpolar interactions. So basically understanding the complexity of this system is what we want to achieve. And basically, we are mainly interested in hemicelluloses in my group, which is, as I said, an important component in plant cell walls. In some tissues, for example, in cereal brands, it's actually up to 50% of the total composition. And these hemicelluloses are, as I said, matrix polysaccharides that interlock cellulose microfibrils, and they have a wide diversity of structures. They have a similar backbone as cellulose, meaning that they have a backbone of beta-1,4 linkages. But differently from cellulose, we can find different sugars in the backbone, glucose, mannose, and xylose. We can find different decorations by both neutral sugars, for example, galactose or arabinose, but also acidic sugars like glucuronic acid. And also we find acetylation, different chemical modifications. So all of these basically complexity of structures have a role. And that's what we are actually very interested in deciphering. So for a long time, people thought that this pattern of sugars was random. So there was no specific ordering in the way that the different backbone sugars, the sugar modifications and the acetylations were placed in the polymer. But actually from very recent years, there has been a lot of progress by us and other researchers in the field using glycomics, so mass spectrometric based glycomics, to try to decipher if there is actually a sequence in the order of the sugars in hemicelluloses. And we had actually found that there are actually regular structures. And now we can start thinking what is actually the implications of these sequencing. So we know now that the different sequences, they are able to modulate macromolecular conformation and chain flexibility. They also fine tune the hydration or aggregation possibilities of these hemicelluloses. They tailor interactions with the other wood component, with the other components in plant cell walls, with the cellulose and with the lignin. And also from an application point of view, they also prevent enzymatic deconstruction and they influence different macroscopic functional properties, like for example, rheological properties when we are making different applications from these hemicelluloses. And I just wanted to highlight just two important contributions that we did recently about, you know, how these sequences might influence plant cell wall assembly. So this is a sketch, a molecular model that we made for the assembly of plant cell walls. So where we actually could find that mannans, for example, with high acetylation are much more flexible, but the presence of a specific regular features in xylan actually tailors the interaction with cellulose. So you can actually find, as you can see here, xylan, which is an important hemicellulose, co-crystallizing on the surface of cellulose. And on the other hand, you can find also other motifs with a high clustering of glucuronic acid, which actually interact with the phenolic component. So it has a big implication on the assembly of plant cell walls. But also, when we're trying to make different cell wall components, we have also found that this molecular structure influence the way these hemicelluloses assemble. So we can find rigid layers of hemicelluloses closely absorbed onto cellulose surfaces, and also flexible xylan components. And this we discovered that it's very important to change the properties of this cellulosic fibrillar network. So having xylan drastically increases the ductility of these fibrillar networks, and having mannan drastically increase the compressibility of this cellular network. So we published that last year in collaboration with the University of Queensland in Australia. And it has also implications for food applications, because we can actually now, combining hemicelluloses and cellulose, we could maybe fine tune different gel materials that can be used for in dietary fiber applications. But now, jumping onto the main topic of the talk today, I wanted to show you a project that we've been driving for some years now, trying to valorize byproducts from cereal production and how X-ray scattering techniques have really helped us to understand the properties of the different food products that we are creating from these cereal byproducts. So the starting point of this project, we were collaborating together with Landman and Novozymes, was to valorize the outer layer of the cereal grain, the bran, which constitutes approximately 20% of the overall cereal kernel. And again, I put here the same picture again. We were very interested in valorizing particularly the arabinoxylans, the hemicelluloses in cereal bran, because they constitute approximately, again, 50% of the total composition. In order to do that, we designed a process using just water in high pressure and temperature, what we call subcritical water extraction. And this allowed us to isolate and fractionate these feruloylated arabinoxylans, these wonderful orange strings here, with high molecular weight at around 100,000 Dalton, and most importantly, keeping these phenolic acids covalently bound to the hemicellulose structure. And you will see now why this is so important to us. On one side, keeping this phenolic acid actually keeps and gives this hemicellulose some antioxidant properties that are quite important in different applications. So, and this is actually part of Cecile's PhD work. What we wanted to see if we could use these ferulolated arabinoxylans making films that could be used as barriers, combining not only the oxygen properties of the films, but also the antioxidant properties of this ferulic acid covalently bound. And we did prove that. So we could see that we could make self-standing films that were favored by the molecular composition of these arabinoxylans. And we found that ferulic acid in covalent form provided higher antioxidant activity to these films rather than have, you know, free ferulic acid added to the film. In the second part of Cecile's project, we wanted to make gels of these feruloylated arabinoxylans. And in order to do that, we basically mimicked what cereal cells do when they're creating their cell walls. So what we did was using the presence of this ferulic acid, we used LINXS oxidation to create radicals and be able to recreate these covalent bonds in these gels. And you can see here that when we do this enzymatic reaction, we decrease the amount of ferulic acid and we increase the amount of these diferulic bridges that we can find. Also, by size exclusion chromatography, we confirmed that these covalent bound structures on one half have higher molecular weight than the free ferulylated arabinoxylan, but also smaller sizes. You can see here a shift to smaller hydrodynamic sizes. So basically we're creating a more compact polymeric topology, but with higher molecular weight. Then we teamed up with Patricia Lopez Sanchez at Chalmers, and she helped us doing a rheological analysis, and we prepared different gels. So first of all, you can see here the appearance of the gels by enzymatic cross-linking, and here after we did some regeneration of these gels by freeze-drying and resuspending at different pHs. And you can see here how the viscosity drastically increases when we have the cross-link, but also even more when we regenerated the films after freeze drying. And here you can see in cryo SEM, the porous structure of these films. But at this stage, we had no idea about how the ultrastructure of these gels looked like. And this is when I have to again give the credit to Cecile. She was really pushy. I really want to understand, I really want to get to know better synchrotron and scattering techniques. So it was her idea to apply to this Vinova project to increase the knowledge base of in scattering techniques. And we were very happy also to couple with Thomas Privilege at Max IV Laboratory. We've been trying to collaborate for some years, and Vinova gave us the opportunity to do that. So we're very thankful to do that. And it has actually highlighted so much the importance to go beyond molecular level and understand supramolecular organization. So first of all, we did some wide angle X-ray scattering from both the polymeric and the cross-link films. And we could see basically that the local crystallinity increased both upon enzymatic cross-linking, but it was not so much influenced by regeneration. You can see here that it almost, the crystallinity degree doubles when we are cross-linking enzymatically. Then we moved forward and we did some preliminary lab scale small angle X-ray scattering from both the cross-linked and the regenerated films. Here you can see the preliminary results that we obtained also in the lab source at Chalmers. And we decided to feed the results from SACS to the correlation length equation with these two terms, the N exponent, the power law for larger aggregates, and then the Lorentz exponent and the correlation length for the polymeric range. And this has really helped us to really understand what happens to our gels. And we're now in the discussion on trying to propose a model of how does this supramolecular organization of our films, of our gels look like. So we've seen that regeneration causes a larger power law exponent. So we're thinking that this creates a higher density of the clusters. We are also finding a larger correlation length upon regeneration. And then we can see that basically we have junctions of the polymeric chains where we have higher order, but we also have a more density and larger clusters at larger orders of size. And we can see that these films combine both chemical cross-linking and physical effects that contribute to both hydrogen bonding, that contribute both to network formation and to the rheological properties. And now we're very excited because next week we will be running the first analysis at the COSACS beamline in Lund. And hopefully Cecile will be able to go in September to Lund to basically further down the study of these complex gels. So I just wanted to finish. I think I'm preaching for the converted here, but it's very important for all of us in the food science area to understand structure because it correlates basically to the raw materials, processing products, and health. But also from my standpoint, what I have learned a lot in this last year is the need to integrate the biochemical analysis that we are mainly experts in my lab at KTH, but also with advanced biophysical characterization. And that's what exactly a neutron X-ray scattering can provide. It's a further understanding of other orders of magnitude. And also from this presentation, I just wanted to highlight as an example, the complex composition of molecular structure and architecture of plant-based materials and how hemicelluloses basically contribute to this assembly at a molecular level, and how we can use these hemicelluloses as valuable matrices for packaging applications, as I can show you, with antioxidant properties, but also as food gels that can also contribute to texture, but also hopefully adding some nutritional benefits in terms of prebiotic activity and also antioxidant properties. And I just wanted to again thank my group, but especially to Cecil, who will present her thesis on the 4th of November. So if you're interested in basically a bit more of the detail that I have provided today, please contact me and I will provide you the link for her presentation. And finally, of course, I wanted to thank the support in this particular case from Formas to the overall project and specifically to Vinova for actually giving us the possibility, not only to Cecil, but also for PIs that are completely unaware of X-ray scattering techniques, of the potential of this platform. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Fran. Very interesting, a very fast presentation.